Harper Business and Harper Audio present Magic Words by Jonah Berger. Read by Keith Nobbs. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/pages/magicwords. It contains notes and charts and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. To anyone who has ever marveled at the power of words. Introduction. When he was just over a year old, our son, Jasper, started saying the word please, or at least trying to. He couldn't pronounce his L's yet, so it ended up sounding more like peas, but it was close enough for us to get the main thrust of what he was saying. His use of the word in itself wasn't that surprising. After all, by 6 months old, most kids can recognize basic sounds, and around a year, they can usually say 1 to 3 words. What was interesting, though, was the way he'd use it. He'd say something he wanted, like up, yo, yogurt, or brow bear, his stuffed brown bear, and then pause to note the result. If he got what he wanted right away, that would be it. He wouldn't say anything else. But if he didn't get what he wanted, or if you seemed to be doing anything other than hustling to get him what he'd asked for, he'd look you straight in the eye, nod his head, and say the word, peas. As Jasper got older, his vocabulary grew. He started talking about his favorite creatures, Dido for dinosaurs, things he wanted to do, wee for slides, and counting, 2. He even added the word yeah to follow peas to show that he really meant business, as in, yo, peas, yeah, or translated to adult English, yes, I'd like yogurt. I mean it. But peas was special, because peas was the first time he realized that words have power, that they drive action, that if he wanted something and it wasn't coming, adding the word peas would make it happen, or at least make it more likely. Jasper had discovered his first magic word. Almost everything we do involves words. We use words to communicate ideas, express ourselves, and connect with loved ones. They're how leaders lead, salespeople sell, and parents parent. They're how teachers teach, policymakers govern, and doctors explain. Even our private thoughts rely on language. By some estimates, we use around 16,000 words a day. We write emails, build presentations, and talk to friends, colleagues, and clients. We draft online dating profiles, chat with neighbors, and touch base with partners to see how their day went. But while we spend a lot of time using language, we rarely think about the specific language we use. Sure, we might think about the ideas we want to communicate, but we think a lot less about the particular words we use to communicate them. And why should we? Individual words often seem interchangeable. Take the third-to-last sentence you just heard. While it used the word particular to refer to words, it could have just as easily used the word individual, specific, or any number of other synonyms. While getting our point across is obviously important, the particular words used to do so often seem inconsequential. Happenstance turns of phrase, or whatever happened to come to mind. But it turns out that intuition is wrong. Very wrong. The word that changed the world. In the 1940s, one word was enough to change the world. Whenever disaster struck or evildoers threatened to destroy life as we know it, comic book teenager Billy Batson would say Shazam and transform into a superhero with extraordinary strength and speed. Such magic words have been around forever, from abracadabra and hocus pocus to open sesame and expecto patronum. Magicians, wizards, and heroes of all stripes have used language to conjure up mystical powers. Like enchanting spells, certain words used strategically could change or do anything. Listeners were powerless to resist them. clearly fiction, right? Not quite. In the late 1970s, researchers from Harvard University approached people using a copy machine in the library at the City University of New York and asked them for a favor. New York is known for its vibrant culture, tasty food, and diverse melting pot of people, but friendliness? Not so much. New Yorkers are known for talking fast, working hard, and always being in a rush. So getting them to inconvenience themselves to help a stranger would be difficult, to say the least. The researchers were interested in what drives persuasion. A member of the team would wait at a table in the library for someone to start making copies. When the would-be copier placed material on the machine, the team member would intervene. They would walk over to the innocent bystander, interrupt what that person was doing, and ask to cut in front and use the machine. The researchers tried different approaches. For some people, they made a direct request. "Excuse me, I have 5 pages. May I use the Xerox machine?" For others, they added the word "because," as in, "Excuse me, I have 5 pages. May I use the Xerox machine because I'm in a rush?" The two approaches were almost identical. Both politely said, "Excuse me," both asked to use the machine, and both noted the 5 pages that needed to be copied. The imposition was the same as well. In both cases, the would-be copier had to stop what they're doing, take their material off the copier, and twiddle their thumbs while someone else went ahead of them. But the two approaches, while similar, had vastly different effects. Adding the word "because" boosted the number of people who let the researcher skip the line by over 50%. A 50% increase in persuasion due to just one word is huge, astronomical even. But to be fair, one could argue that the two approaches differed in more than just one word. After all, the approach that included the word "because" didn't just add that word, it also added a reason for the request. In other words, that the requester was in a rush. So rather than "because" driving persuasion, maybe people were more likely to say yes because the reason for the request was really good. The requester said they were in a rush and the innocent bystander wasn't, so maybe they said yes just to be polite or helpful. But that wasn't it, because the researchers also tried one more approach. For a third set of people, rather than giving a valid reason, the requester gave a meaningless one. "Excuse me, I have 5 pages. May I use the Xerox machine because I have to make copies?" That time, the requester's reason didn't add any new information. After all, by asking to use the copier, it was already clear that the requester needed to make copies. So tacking on that one word "because" shouldn't have mattered. If giving a valid reason was what boosted persuasion, then saying they needed to use the machine because they needed to make copies shouldn't have helped. In fact, given that the reason was meaningless, it might even reduce persuasion, making people less likely to agree. But that's not what happened. Rather than decreasing persuasion, including a meaningless reason actually increased it, just as much as the valid reason did. Persuasion wasn't driven by the reason itself. It was driven by the power of the word that came before it, because. The copy machine study is just one example of the power of magic words. Saying you recommend rather than like something makes people 32% more likely to take your suggestion. Using the word "whom" in online dating profiles makes men 31% more likely to get a date. Adding more prepositions to a cover letter makes you 24% more likely to get the job. And saying "is not" rather than "isn't" when describing a product makes people pay $3 more to get it. The language used in earnings calls influences company stock price, and the language used by CEOs impacts investment returns. How do we know all this? From the new science of language. Technological advances in machine learning, computational linguistics, and natural language processing, combined with the digitization of everything from cover letters to conversations, have revolutionized our ability to analyze language, yielding unprecedented insights. I started using automated text analysis by accident. In the mid-2000s, I was a first-year professor at the Wharton School, doing research on why things catch on. We were interested in why people talk about and share some things rather than others, and I'd compiled a data set of thousands of New York Times articles, everything from front page and world news to sports and lifestyle content. Many of the articles were great reads, but only a small portion made it onto the site's most emailed list, and we were trying to figure out why. To find out, we needed to measure different reasons content might go viral. Maybe articles featured on the Times homepage get more attention, for example, so we measured that. Similarly, maybe certain sections have more readers or certain writers have larger audiences, so we measured those things as well. We were particularly interested in whether certain ways of writing might make articles more likely to be shared, but figuring that out required finding a way to measure features of the articles, like how much emotion each article evoked, or how much useful information it contained. We started by enlisting research assistants. Interested undergraduates would email me asking if they could get involved with research, and this was an easy way they could help out. Each student would read an article and rate it on things like whether it evoked a little emotion or a lot. This approach worked pretty well, at least initially. They coded a few articles and then a few dozen. But applying this method to thousands of articles didn't work so well. It took time for a research assistant to read an article, and reading 10, 100, or 1,000 articles took 10, 100, or 1,000 times as long. We hired a small army of research assistants, but even then, progress was slow. Further, the more people we hired, the less sure we were that we were getting consistent results. One research assistant might feel that a particular article was emotional, while another didn't, and we were worried that those inconsistencies would hurt our conclusions. We needed an objective method that would scale. A consistent way to measure things across thousands of articles without making our research assistants tired and burnt out. I started talking to some colleagues, and someone suggested a computer program called Linguistic Inquiry and Word Count. The program was brilliantly simple. Users inputted a block of text, for example, newspaper article or anything else, and the program would spit out scores on various dimensions. By counting the number of emotion-related words appearing in an article, for example, the program gauged whether that article was more or less focused on emotion. Unlike research assistants, the program never got tired. Further, it was perfectly consistent. It always coded things the same way. Linguistic Inquiry and Word Count, or LIWC as it is often known, became my favorite new research tool. If you're interested in LIWC, check out James W. Pennebaker's excellent book, The Secret Life of Pronouns. Wisdom from Words. In the decades since then, hundreds of new tools and approaches have emerged. Methods for counting particular terms, discovering the main themes in a document, and extracting wisdom from words. And just as the microscope revolutionized biology and the telescope upended astronomy, natural language processing tools have transformed the social sciences, providing insight into all types of human behavior. We've parsed customer service calls to uncover the words that increase customer satisfaction, dissected conversations to understand why some go better than others, and scrutinized online articles to identify writing that keeps readers engaged. We've examined thousands of movie scripts to determine why some become blockbusters, studied tens of thousands of academic papers to understand how to write for impact, and analyzed millions of online reviews to learn how language influences word of mouth. We've parsed patient interactions to identify what increases medical adherence, dissected parole hearings to uncover what makes an effective apology, and examined legal arguments to discover what wins cases. We've scrutinized the scripts of tens of thousands of TV shows to figure out what makes a good story, and analyzed over 250,000 song lyrics to identify what makes a hit. Along the way, I've seen the power of magic words. Yes, what we say matters. but some words are more impactful than others. The right words used at the right time can change minds, engage audiences, and drive action. So what are these magic words, and how can we take advantage of their power? This book uncovers the hidden science behind how language works, and more important, how we can use it more effectively to persuade others, deepen relationships, and be more successful at home and at work. Specifically, we'll discuss six types of magic words. Words that, 1, activate identity and agency.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.